Once acetaminophen is delivered to the liver, hepatocytes can metabolize acetaminophen by three pathways. The two major pathways are conjugation of acetaminophen with sulfate with production of acetaminophen sulfate and conjugation of acetaminophen with glucuronide with production of acetaminophen glucuronide. And the third pathway, paracetamol, can be oxidized by cytochrome P450 enzymes with production of highly reactive and dangerous metabolite N-acetyl-p-benzoquinonimine. In therapeutic doses, most of the paracetamol is metabolized by glucuronidation and sulfation, and only 5% of acetaminophen is transformed into N-acetyl-benzoquinonimine, and there is reason for it. N-acetylbenzoquinonimine is an extremely dangerous substance that covalently binds to cellular proteins and totally disrupts their structure and thereby their function. And because it's a very dangerous substance, it must be immediately detoxified. And this detoxification is provided by glutathione. Glutathione rapidly conjugates with N-acetylbenzoquinonimine with formation of a harmless substance, mercapturic acid, that can be excreted into the urine. Very important that this conjugation occurs almost immediately, and because of that, N-acetylbenzoquinonimine does not have enough time to bind to any cellular proteins. So basically, as far as glutathione stores are full, cell is perfectly safe. But in paracetamol overdose, the amount of acetaminophen that income from circulation into the liver tissue becomes so high that these two pathways are simply overwhelmed by a huge amount of acetaminophen. And in these circumstances, more and more acetaminophen molecules are oxidized by cytochrome P450 enzymes, and this results in increase in production of N-acetylbenzoquinonimine. Glutathione immediately conjugates with N-acetylbenzoquinonimine, thereby detoxifying it. But the more acetaminophen income into the liver tissue, the more depleted become glutathione stores. And at some point, glutathione stores become so depleted that there is no glutathione to bind N-acetylbenzoquinonimine, and free N-acetylbenzoquinonimine molecules covalently bind to hepatocyte proteins in the cytosol and also in the mitochondria. So N-acetylbenzoquinonimine caused damage to cellular proteins in the cytosol, but also it caused damage to mitochondrial proteins. This substance binds mostly to proteins of mitochondrial electron transport chain, and damage to them results in leakage of electrons from electron transport chain. These free electrons react with oxygen with formation of superoxide, which is free radical. And also, N-acetylbenzoquinonimine binds to ATPase, which is the final complex in electron transport chain, and this disrupts mitochondrial ATP production, thereby also leading to bioenergetic failure of the cell. To explain this, recall that on the inner mitochondrial membrane located electron transport chain that is composed of four protein complexes and coenzyme Q, and also there is fifth complex called ATP synthase that has its own unique function. And the concept is that protein complexes in electron transport chain transport electrons from one complex to another, and by this electron flow they produce energy to drive hydrogen protons at the level of complex 1, 3, and 4 from mitochondrial matrix into the intramembrane space. This creates hydrogen proton concentration gradient across inner mitochondrial membrane, with high hydrogen proton concentration gradient in intramembrane space and low concentration at mitochondrial matrix. And ATP synthase uses concentration gradient, and by transportation of hydrogen ions from intramembrane space into mitochondrial matrix, it generates energy that results in production of ATP molecules. Important that after complex 4 sucks the last portion of energy out of electron, now low energy electron without energy inside has to be utilized, and complex 4 throw out this low energy electron from electron transport chain to oxygen inside the mitochondrial matrix, and electrons bind to oxygen and reduce oxygen with formation of water molecules. But even in a normal condition, electron transport chain is not perfect, and some electrons can leak out of electron transport chain, and in this situation they reduce oxygen in another fashion. They reduce oxygen with formation of superoxide, which is reactive oxygen species. So when N-acetylbenzoquinonimine binds to proteins in electron transport chain, this causes increase in the amount of electrons that leak out from electron transport chain, thereby it causes increase in superoxide production. And also when N-acetylbenzoquinonimine binds to ATPase and disrupts its function, Without ATPase, hydrogen transportation by concentration gradient becomes impossible, thereby energy cannot be generated. Also, without ATPase, ATP cannot be degraded to ADP. So even if cell has some amount of ATP molecules, the energy inside them cannot be released. And progressive decrease in amount of ATP molecules, together with decrease in hydrolysis of ATP molecules, at some point cause bioenergetic failure of the cell. Superoxide immediately converted by superoxide dismutase to hydrogen peroxide, and excessive accumulation of hydrogen peroxide called oxidative stress. And the specific feature of hydrogen peroxide is that hydrogen peroxide can be oxidized by ferrum in Fenton reaction with formation of hydroxyl radical, which is highly reactive substance that causes oxidative damage to lipids in the cellular membranes, cellular proteins, and to DNA molecule. And also superoxide molecules bind to nitric oxide with formation of peroxynitrate, which is very potent oxidant that induces so-called nitrosative stress. And both oxidative stress and nitrosative stress cause two major pathological events. It's nitroso redox imbalance and mitochondrial permeability transition. In terms of redox imbalance, we have to know that hydrogen peroxide as well as peroxynitrate are mediators of intracellular signaling. This process is called redox signaling and nitrosative signaling. Basically, hydrogen peroxide and peroxynitrate can modify intracellular proteins by oxidation or nitration, and these modifications change proteins' physical and chemical properties. By this, these two substances can regulate protein function. But the important feature of redox and nitrosative signaling is that these modifications must be reversible. Because, for example, if we turn on the enzyme, at some point it must be turned off. And to be reversible, these modifications require a very limited and precise amount of hydrogen peroxide and peroxynitrate. And with acetaminophen-induced excessive generation of superoxide, the level of hydrogen peroxide and peroxynitrate progressively increased. And at some point they reach the critical level when they irreversibly modify cellular proteins. And exactly this condition called nitroso-redox imbalance. So for example, once they activate enzyme will be always in activated state. So it's a big deal because it totally disrupts intracellular signaling and basically makes total mess inside the cell. Also, both hydrogen peroxide and peroxynitrate are able to induce mitochondrial permeability transition. The concept is that hydrogen peroxide and peroxynitrate induce opening of mitochondrial permeability transition pores, and this markedly increases permeability of the inner mitochondrial membrane, which is in normal condition impermeable. Exactly this condition called mitochondrial permeability transition. Once mitochondrial permeability transition occurs, it's a point of no return, because first of all, it causes uncoupling of oxidative phosphorylation that decreases ATP production, and at some point it causes bioenergetic failure of the cell. And also it causes mitochondrial swelling that leads to a mitochondrial rupture. And this mitochondrial rupture, cytochrome C is released from mitochondria, and inside the cell, cytochrome C induces intrinsic apoptotic pathway. And calcium that was stored in mitochondrial matrix also released into the cytosol. And this results in calcium overload that induces mitochondrial permeability transition on other cellular mitochondria. Thereby, this creates positive feedback loop that leads to a cellular death. So, oxidative stress and nitrosative stress induce two major pathological events. It's nitroso-redox imbalance and mitochondrial permeability transition. As we see, for a proper intracellular signaling, the level of hydrogen peroxide and peroxynitrate inside the cell must be strictly controlled. And to maintain them at a proper level, cell has specific antioxidant that is called glutathione peroxidase that detoxify both hydrogen peroxide and peroxynitrate. And the most important is that the cofactor of glutathione peroxidase is glutathione. And in case of acetaminophen intoxication, when glutathione stores are already depleted, there is no glutathione for glutathione peroxidase. Thereby, the level of hydrogen peroxide and peroxynitrate progressively increased. This caused severe oxidative and nitrosative stress that caused nitroso-redox imbalance and induced mitochondrial permeability transition. Altogether, oxidative damage, nitroso-redox imbalance, mitochondrial permeability transition, bioenergetic failure of the cell. For cell, it's too much to bear, and obviously this will result in acetaminophen-induced hepatocyte death. So basically, it's the mechanism of acetaminophen-induced liver injury.